psychedelic or clueless.
Well, I probably did say that. They probably had gotten me loaded before the interview. I think it was Oscar Wilde who said, I contradict myself. A real index of intelligence is humor. You know, it requires great affection for people and the world and the act of being, a forgivingness and a bemusement. The sure sign of the fanatic is an absence of humor or self-distancing. I mean, you have to realize how preposterous it is that a bunch of monkeys in blue jeans would sit around trying to figure out how the cosmos works. I mean, what would you think if you were out in the bush and came upon a conclave of termites discussing the same thing? I mean, you'd think it was ridiculous, but the distance between us and them is minuscule. So, you know, what is it really about other than creating a shared sense of understanding that persists in the moment? Shamanism is show business, and philosophy is a branch of that vaudevillian impulse. And doing philosophy is just a way of thinking using some rules so that you don't make really dumb mistakes, you know. And then using those rules, you can at least sort of get to a kind of a place. I mean, I am totally against ideology. I think we're not looking for ideologies, we're looking for understanding. And clinging to ideologies is a kind of immature stage in intellectual development. Later in life, people who are doing it right, I think, give up all ideology. And have a much, you know, I mean, if life doesn't mellow you, then nothing will learn. What is the human relationship to language? And is language hardwired? And how old is it? And I'm coming to the conclusion that part of our problem is always also our glory. Part of our problem and our glory is that we are thoroughly enmeshed in language. We are infected by a language virus big time. And I think that it's been difficult to think about this problem because in ordinary English, no distinction is made between language and speech. And that language is something very old. Bees do it, ants do it, certainly all social primates do it. Language, it's very old, and it's gestural, pheromonal, situational, always haunted by ambiguity, always open to misinterpretation. But spoken language is as modern as the bicycle pump. It is a technology. It is not basic to humanness. It's something somebody invented, probably in Africa, no more than 35,000 years ago. And it was essentially the most amazing parlor trick slash technology anybody ever brought online. And what it is it's the ability to associate an acoustical signifier with an intention that it has no logical relationship to. It is simply an assigned relationship. And once it was invented, it has certain qualities that made it very hard to put it down. It's like the internet. In fact, it's part of that program of development. The previous forms of communication were gestural and touchy-feely, and therefore very intimate. You couldn't make speeches. Literally, you couldn't make speeches. Spoken language works in darkness. This is a great boon on gestural communication. Apparently, the rules, the syntactical rules used to organize thinking, which were very old, and as Chomsky has shown, do have roots in genetics, they can just as easily be used to organize acoustical modalities as neurological modalities. In other words, grammar was a control system for thought, but since it can be a control system for any serialized population of wave mechanical phenomena, it can also work for spoken speech. And so we'd find you had grammar before you had spoken speech. The grammar was already there, and the spoken speech just ran along the runnels previously reserved for thought. All of this probably under the perturbation of psychedelic chemicals back in the climax Saharan grassland of the high Paleolithic.
Funny ideas are always a threat to the established order.
The world is made of language, and energy follows attention. So, you know, politicians, advertising, mavens, people like this know how to sculpt expectation into self-fulfilling prophecy. And, you know, essentially we're living inside a collective hallucination called the cultural vision. And it's sustained by languages and ideologies, and it has its own inner dynamic that's completely incomprehensible to anyone outside of it and makes perfect sense to everyone inside of it. So for instance, you know, flashback to the 14th century. Trying animals for murder and shaving your head and wearing starched wigs and believing that God was in his heaven and the Pope was in Rome, this all made perfect sense to people. It was a cultural hallucination of some sort. Where the problem has come, and it's come with increasing frequency since the invention of civilization, is the cultural illusion is fine until someone comes who isn't sharing the hallucination, and they carry with them cognitive dissonance. And in early civilizations, it was probably traders. You know, you had these folks over here at Ur, and they all were living in one hallucination, and somebody here at Uridu had it. But then these guys would come who it wasn't working in their heads like it was for everybody else. But they were necessary because they brought dope, basically, and news and dope. In other words, commodities and information. Now in the modern world, what we have is not a culture, but a megaculture where these balkanized epistemologies, like over here people are practicing voodoo, over here they're practicing quantum physics, and here Mormonism, these are balkanized epistemologies, are all trying to coexist with each other under a meta framework of democratic liberalism, and these memes are furiously competing. Almost all of them, whatever their apparent freight, are creatures of one dimension or two dimensions. The psychedelic meme seems to be different because it doesn't, it proceeds from an experience, not an ideological or doctrinal position, but an experience that is as easily accessed by the critic as the believer. This is unique. You know, if you're not a Mormon, you can't touch the heart of Mormonism. If you're not a Scientologist, you can't touch the heart of Scientology. If you're a critic of psychedelics and you have the guts, you can certainly touch the heart of psychedelica. You simply have to bolt down the 5 dried grams and shut up, and it will overtake you. So in terms of power in the social milieu, this meme has enormous power. It seems to be, it's like a religion with a God that is alive. So there is no need to mediate it through a priesthood, no need to have exegesis. No sacred book is necessary. Maria Sabina says, the mushroom is the book. And she was illiterate, but she swore that on mushrooms she read from a book.
As Terence says, psychedelic or clueless?